Our scripture for this morning is taken from the book of Acts, chapter 2, verses 1 to 4, 12 to 18, and 37 to 39. Hear God speak to us in his word. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like a blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now there were staying in Jerusalem God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard the sound, the crowd came together in bewilderment because each one heard him speaking in his own language. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Are not all these men who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in his own native language? Parthians, Medes, and Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, and Cappadocia, Pontus, and Asia, Phrygia, and Pamphylia, Egypt, and parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs. We hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues." Amazed and perplexed, they asked one another, "What does this mean?" Some, however, made fun of them and said they have just had too much wine. Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and addressed the crowd. "Fellow Jews and all of you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. These men are not drunk, as you supposed. It's only 9 in the morning. No, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God said, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy." When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, "Brothers, what shall we do?" Peter replied, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you and your children, and for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord our God will call." We thank you, Lord, for this good news of your holy word. Amen. Please be seated. As we gather here today, it's a holiday or a holy day. Just like Christmas or Easter, Pentecost is a day that we celebrate the completion of God's salvation story. And to do this, we all need to know the story. And the story is the Bible, God's story, history. I like that word history. It's his story, the Bible, the book. And we, each of us as Christians, should know about this book. For example, can you share with other people that the Old Testament is the story of God's preparing a people to save the world through the Messiah? It begins with God calling Abraham, an old man who was promised a special son. And he was promised that from Abraham's line would come a Messiah who would bless the whole world. The Old Testament is the story of God sending Moses to free his people and bring them to a promised land. It's the story of kings and people, sometimes close to God and sometimes abandoning God. The Old Testament is the story of prophets warning mankind of the penalty of sin and mighty empires enslaving God's people and then releasing them to go back home. The Old Testament is the story of the prophets proclaiming to the world the Messiah of David's line who would be born in Bethlehem. And then we come to the New Testament, the fulfillment of the promises, the coming of the Messiah, Jesus' suffering, his death and his resurrection and his ascension into heaven. Now, what was necessary to complete the whole story? The coming of the Holy Spirit. This promise. Jesus had previously given this promise about his church that the gates of hell will not prevail against my church. So the only promise of the Bible which is left to be fulfilled is Jesus' return to judge the living and the dead. Now, Pentecost tells us many important things that the world has gotten confused over the years. For example, Pentecost tells us the church is not a collection of buildings. The church is God's living presence in human lives. So here we are, the church gathered together. Out there, we're the church scattered. Pentecost is the Holy Spirit sending us out to wherever we are, in our families, in our workplaces, in schools, to proclaim good news of God's grace to everyone who will believe that Jesus is Christ. Now, we know the church seems to be divided. There are many denominations. Yet Pentecost proclaims there's really only one church, and we're united by our faith in Jesus Christ and the essentials which are taught in Scripture. So the Holy Spirit sent the disciples out to proclaim this good news to the people. We had in Sunday school how, you might remember, with the Tower of Babel, mankind came together against God. They tried to raise a tower into heaven, and what did God do? He confounded them. And that's why we have so many confounded languages today that we can't understand. But do you notice that Pentecost, this was reversed. At Pentecost, the Holy Spirit came and they went out and could speak to everyone in their own language. And I said this is the heart of the Reformation as well. Because before the Reformation, the Bible was only in Latin, and a priest would have to interpret it for you. And the heart of the Reformation was the Bible should be in people's own language. And the only mediator we have is Jesus Christ. So the story of Pentecost is how the Holy Spirit descended upon 120 disciples gathered in that upper room in Jerusalem. Easter proclaims that Jesus is risen. Pentecost proclaims Christ is in us. Easter proclaims God's pardon. Pentecost proclaims God's power. In Acts 19, the Apostle Paul was asked the Ephesians, did you receive the Holy Spirit when you believed? And they answered, no, we've never even heard that there is a Holy Spirit. And you know, many people are like this today, even Christians. They're just like these Ephesian believers. They don't understand why the Holy Spirit came at Pentecost. The Holy Spirit came to breathe life into us. He came not only as God with us, he's in us by the power of the Holy Spirit, joining us together as Christ's church and pushing us out, giving us the mission to reach people with the good news of Christ. Now, there have been times when Christ's church has grown old and fat and lazy and out of shape from inactivity. And we're content to stay within four walls. And you know, in our time, they're trying not only for us to stay within four walls, they want us to be locked in these four walls and confined to the church buildings. And many times, the church has been the opposite, where they're out in the streets and everywhere, staying true to the gospel. There are some ways people try to bring people into the church, but these programs and pep and promotions and works and gimmicks, the Pentecost proclaims the very simplicity of the gospel, that every believer is given the power to glorify God and to share him with others. And that comes by the Holy Spirit whipping us with the warm flames of our love for Christ. So think of this. What is Pentecost? Is it a day? Is it a denomination? Is it a movement? No. Pentecost is God creating his church and then sending us out with power from on high. The power enables us to love and to serve Jesus Christ wherever we are, wherever we are placed. And you know, in our dry religious day, we need the Holy Spirit to give us a sweet refreshing, helping us laborers to go out into the harvest. And we don't even expect success today, but just look at what we've done in Bentonia, which was a Muslim town. And now that whole area of Sierra Leone is on fire with the gospel. And they're preaching the same sermon that Peter preached on Pentecost. Listen to it. Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you and for your children and for all who are far off, whom the Lord our God will call. So God's going to call them. We're just sent out to bring them in. And the Holy Spirit gives us the power to go out and the authority to go out in Christ's name. And what's the message? The forgiveness of sins and the promise of heaven. Now the real challenge of Pentecost is whether we're willing to go where God is leading us. Listen to Peter's sermon. All who call on the name of the Lord will be saved. This is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. And your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. Jesus said in Luke 24, Behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry in the city of Jerusalem, and you will be endued with power from on high. I want us to think about that power, the power of Christianity today. We all need power. Some of us don't think we have power. I want to tell you a story about power that when Lauren and I lived in Nebraska, I needed a car, a cheap car. So I went to a farmer, and he had this 1974 Mercedes diesel. And I bought that diesel car from his estate, and I was a wonderful, wonderful car. But when I had to go on hospital calls to Lincoln or Omaha, sometimes I would get on Interstate 80, and the speed limit was 75 or 80 miles an hour. And that Mercedes could not get 1 mile above 55. And so you can imagine me driving on Interstate 80, 55 miles an hour, and people didn't even, they were going more than 80 miles an hour. So, and then they would get mad and, you know, tailgate, and I'd put my pedal to the metal, and the only thing came out was black smoke. And that would make them mad. So that diesel was a good car, but it did not have power. And I think some of us as Christians are afraid of that. We're afraid that if we go into the world and we share Jesus Christ with others, we don't have the power to make any influence on them. And really, we don't have to depend on our power, because the Holy Spirit will go before and provide for us. Listen to the Gospel of Luke. Jesus said, How much more will your Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? So Jesus rose into heaven. He commanded his disciples, Wait in Jerusalem, and you will receive power. And that power didn't come, as I said, didn't come from themselves. That power came as God indwelt them. The Holy Spirit dwelt them. And 120 believers in that upper room went out. And soon, that day, there were 3,000 believers in Jerusalem, and the church was born. From there, we read in Acts chapter 8, there was a deacon by the name of Philip. And Philip reached out to the Samaritans. And that was an impossibility. Jews and Samaritans didn't get along. But many Samaritans believed in Jesus and were baptized. In chapter 9, we're told about Saul of Tarsus. There was it was in Damascus, Syria, that place that has the most horrible troubles today. That's the first place that we were called Christians. And Saul of Tarsus went to arrest the Christian church. Well, on the way, on the road to Damascus, Jesus threw Saul off his horse and said, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And Saul was blinded. And so what did the Holy Spirit do? He sent Ananias, a believer, to take Saul of Tarsus into his house. Here Saul came to kill Christians, and here was a Christian taking Saul into his house. And Saul got his sight back, and 3 days later he says, now this is what Ananias had the power to say to Saul of Tarsus. He said, and now what are you waiting for? Get up, be baptized, and wash your sins away, calling on his name. And that was the very beginning of the Apostle Paul's ministry. Now, looking back in my own life, as I've told you before, I made my first, that I can remember, first profession of faith in Jesus Christ as my Savior in second grade when a teacher proclaimed Jesus' invitation. Here I am. I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in and eat with that person and they with me. And so I asked Jesus into my life. Can you imagine how many school children today would respond if teachers were allowed to give that same gospel invitation? We have the child evangelism. They go and we do out-of-school release or after-school release. But can you imagine if every teacher today had the power that they could ask their children, do you want Jesus to come into your heart? I believe we'd have a great, great revival. In 1977, Lauren and I were just getting comfortable living in State College, and I was working at Penn State University when the pastor called. And I never heard of a pastor visiting you except when there was an emergency. And when I was talking with the pastor, I just mentioned to him that I had always felt a call from God to serve him. And it wasn't him, it was God speaking through him. It says, don't wait another minute. Tomorrow, go down and sign up for seminary. And if Christ has called you, he's going to make the way. And that was almost 40 years ago that I began my ministry. And the Holy Spirit speaks with power and always led me straight to Jesus. In Acts chapter 10, the church broke through the ethnic bounds. Israel presumed that the Messiah was for Jews only. But the Holy Spirit gave Peter a dream of a sheet let down from heaven with all kinds of unkosher foods on it. And he commanded Peter, get up and eat. And Peter said, no way will I ever eat unclean food. And the Holy Spirit said, don't call unclean what God has made clean. Peter, what did he do? He went to the house of a Gentile named Cornelius. And Peter preached this good news not only to Cornelius, his whole family, all the people that lived in his household, the men, the women, the children, the slaves, the free, and they all believed, and they all asked to be baptized. And from there, the gospel continued to go out into the world. We read that while he was preaching, the Holy Ghost fell on them, which heard the word. And the Gentiles also were poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost. So the apostles started going out from Jerusalem into Samaria, or Judea and Samaria, further and further away, until they got someplace where our ancestors heard about them. And they became Christians, and from their children, talked about the gifts of God are for believers and their children, passed on generation after generation. But we need to ask ourselves, what does Pentecost have to do with today? The church in America seems to be weaker in our generation than in days past. And we kind of feel enclosed within four walls. But Pentecost says, go on out anyway. You will receive the power of the Holy Spirit until the Lord returns. The church, Christians, we mistakenly look at the church as an institution, as a building, instead of what the church really is, which is a people that are indwelled by the Spirit, filled with Christ. So do you know today, what is the Holy Spirit doing in your life? Because the Bible says that promise is for you and for all who believe, all who will listen, obey, and go out with power. Peter didn't have to go out cold turkey to speak with Cornelius. The Holy Spirit prepared him. And I want to end today with a chorus which we will be singing. Listen to these words. It may not be in the mountain heights or over the stormy sea. It may not be at the battlefront. My Lord will have need of me. But if by a still small voice he calls to pass, I do not know. I'll answer, dear Lord, with my hand in yours. I'll go where you want me to go. I'll go where you want me to go, dear Lord, o'er mountain and plain and sea. I'll say what you want me to say, dear Lord. I'll be what you want me to be. Let us pray. Dear Lord, the day of Pentecost is so important, the birth of your church, and how it's